Good morning, students. So today we are going to do the textbook questions of chapter 9, that is biomolecules. Yes, student, question number 1 is what are macromolecules and give example. As you have learned in the chapter, here the term macromolecules, it is used for biomacromolecules. The student is macromolecules, they are the large complex molecules and that occur in colloidal state in the intercellular fluid. So these macromolecules, they are generally formed by the polymerization of the simplest molecules, which are the micromolecules and which have low molecular weight. As you have learned about chemical analysis, when we done the chemical analysis, then we have two type of pools. One is the acid soluble pool, which is generally the filtrate, and the second one is the acid insoluble pool, which is the retentate. So these macromolecules, they are generally found in the retentate or the acid insoluble pool. The second important property of these macromolecules are their molecular weight is more than 10,000 daltons, whereas the micromolecules which are found in the acid soluble pool, their molecular weight is not more than 1000 daltons. So if we have to give the example, then three macromolecules are there, that is polypeptides or proteins, polysaccharides or carbohydrates, and the third one is nucleic acids or polynucleotides. We have also learnt about lipids, that these lipids, they also are included with macromolecules, but their molecular weight is less than 1000 daltons. And I have also explained the reason that these lipid molecules, they are generally the component of membranes of the cell. So when you break the cell, then these lipids, they comes in the form of vesicles, and because they are hydrophobic in nature, so they float in the hydrophilic solution. That's why they do not come along with the filtrate or acid soluble pool, whereas they come along with the retentate, that is the acid insoluble pool. That's why they are included with these macromolecules whose molecular weight is more than 10,000 daltons. Yes, student, question number 2, illustrate a glycosidic peptide and a phosphodiester bond. So here you have to tell about these three types of bonds and you also draw the chemical structure. So here I have written about glycosidic bond. That glycosidic bond, it is always formed normally between carbon number 1 and carbon number 4 of the neighboring monosaccharide units. So here you can see from this diagram, we have a hexagon ring, and on the 5 positions of this hexagon ring, we have carbon atoms, whereas the 6th position is occupied by an oxygen atom, which is a hetero atom here. So all the carbon atoms, they have OH groups attached with them. And on the 5th carbon atom, there is one group attached, that is CH2OH group, that is hydroxymethyl. So when these are two monomeric units of glucose, they come near to each other. We can take H from this and we can take OH from this. So both H and OH, they form water molecule. And the rest of the oxygen atom, they join these two adjacent carbons. So in this way, this COC type of linkage is known as a glycosidic linkage. Yes, student, you always remember that peptide bonds always formed between amino acids when they linked together to form proteins, which are polypeptides. So here you can see the general formula of two amino acids. So we have tetravalent carbon in the center and it has NH2 group attached at its left hand side and COOH group attached on its right hand side. And similarly, the same thing is also for another amino acid. So from this carboxylate group, we can take OH, and from this amine group, we can take H. So this H and OH, they later removed from the reaction in the form of water molecule. This means the reaction is a dehydration reaction, and rest of the things, that is CO from this side and NH from this side, they join together. So this CO and H type of linkages which join these adjacent molecules of amino acids, it is known as peptide linkage. Yes, student, here I have again draw the glycosidic linkage. You go through this. Yes, student, phosphodiester bond always develop between the nucleic acid. As you know that one of the example of nucleic acid is DNA. So here this DNA has a double helical structure. This means this is the sugar molecule and phosphate group of one strand of DNA, and this is the sugar molecule and phosphate group of another strand of DNA. So I have here shown you what happened in the first strand. So this is a sugar molecule. It is represented by a pentagon ring having how many carbons? 1, 2, 3, 4 carbons are there. And at the fifth position, a heteroatom oxygen is present. And on the fourth carbon, there is one group attached. That is CH2OH group. The student, please forget for some time this phosphate group, that is PO4 actually. So remember, at the fourth position, we have CH2OH group present. And on the adjacent sugar molecule, at the third carbon, there is one OH group present. So from this CH2OH, we take one H, and this whole OH we take from this side. So water molecule is removed, and rest of the things, they get attached. Similarly, the same thing, it also happens in case of this second strand between the two sugar molecules. So the phosphoester bond always develop between carbon number 3 of one sugar molecule and carbon number 5, that is CH2OH, of the another sugar molecule. So both of these carbon 1 and carbon 5, they are attached with the help of phosphate ions. So that's why two types of phosphoester bonds develops on each of the strands. That's why it is known as phosphodiester bond. Yes, student, question number 3 is, what is meant by tertiary structure of proteins? So you know very well that proteins, they always exist in the form of long chain of polypeptides. And all of these polypeptide chains, they are made up of amino acids, which are joined in end-to-end fashion, in a chain-like fashion, having peptide bonds between them. So the tertiary structure of protein says that these long protein chains, they are folded upon itself like a hollow woolen ball. This means some of the protein threads, they are in open form, having folds, whereas the rest of the protein threads or protein fibers, they are binded, interbind with each other in a three-dimensional manner. So this structure, it gives the three-dimensional view of the proteins. So the advantage of this tertiary structure of protein is that when the proteins, they exist in their tertiary structure, then they are playing the role of enzyme, because this tertiary structure has so many pockets and folds present in them. And these pockets and folds, they act as the active site of the enzyme, where the substrate, they later binds and do the catalysis, okay? Yes, student, here the tertiary structure of the enzyme is very much visible to you. So this is somewhat like the Hollen-Bullen ball. And here some of the threads, they get open, and so many pocket-like structures are formed. And you know, this pocket-like structure are actually the active site. So here, when the proteins, they are present in their tertiary structure, they are doing the role of enzymes. Yes, student, a general question is there. Proteins have primary structure. If you are given a method to know which amino acid is at either side of the two termini or ends of a protein, can you connect this information to purity or homogeneity of a protein? The student, answer is yes. If we are given a method to know the sequence of the proteins, then we can use this information for finding the purity of the protein, because it is known to us from that particular reference structure that what is the sequence of amino acids that is present in that particular sequence. So if we know the exact location of each amino acid in that reference structure, we compare the another structure, which is the structure of an unknown protein, with this reference structure and see the location of each amino acid. If there is any change in the location of the amino acid, this means the protein which is formed from that polypeptide chain is also going to be changed. So in this way, I want to give an example here that the sequence of hemoglobin. If there is any change in the sequence of hemoglobin, which is an example of a protein, it is made up of two chains, alpha chain and beta chain, then you see that the RBCs, they have lesser quantity of hemoglobin, they become the sickle shape because of changes in the polypeptide chains which constitute this hemoglobin. Yes, student. Question number six is: find out and make a list of proteins used as a therapeutic agents, and find other applications of proteins, for example, cosmetics, etc. So your answer is: we have different type of proteins that can be used as a therapeutic agents. So here you can give the example of thrombin and fibrinogens. Both of these are used in blood clotting. Then we have antigen and antibodies. So whenever we have to use blood during blood transfusion process, so in that case we have to match the antigens and the antibodies, because every antigen has a specific type of antibodies in the body. If both of them they are not as they are required, so in that case clumping of the blood cells takes place and death may takes place in severe cases. Second is third one is insulin. So here you know that insulin is a kind of a protein, and it is quite helpful in maintaining blood glucose level in your body. Then we have renin enzyme. So this renin enzyme, it play an important role in osmoregulation or maintaining ionic balance of the body. So in this way, proteins, they are also used in manufacture of so many cosmetics, toxins, and biological buffers. That is the ionic balance, the neutral medium that is very much required in your body, because there are certain chemical reactions that can takes place in these buffer systems. So in cosmetics, you can also give the example of various types of face washes and shampoos, as well as detergent, soaps, etc. that you use for your daily purpose. So all of these, they are quite helpful in removing the oily stains from your clothes, because in these detergents, the lipases enzymes are present, and these are hydrophobic in nature, so they pick up these oily stains from your clothes, and in this way, your clothes get stained. Yes, question number seven is: explain the composition of triglyceride. So always remember, a triglyceride is a glyceride which is formed from a single molecule of glycerol, and here glycerol is 1,2,3-propyntriol. And when its esterification is done with 3 fatty acids, then triglycerides are formed. So they are present in vegetable oils and fats. Here I have written the general formula of these triglycerides. So here R1, R2 and R3 are the respective fatty acids. So these fatty acids may be same or it may be different. Okay, student, here you can see the structure of the glycerol. We have 1, 2, 3. This means 3 carbons are there, so it is propane. And it is a substituted propane, because here we have 3 hydroxyl groups which are attached with these 3 respective carbons by substitution of 1 hydrogen atom from this. So this is 1,2,3-propyntriol, which is glycerol. And here you can see the fatty acids. And these fatty acids, after undergoing esterification, so what happened? Here from the glycerol we take these 3 OH groups. And here from these fatty acids, we take all the 3 hydrogen atoms. So here in this reaction, esterification, all the other groups, they join together, and 3 molecules of water, they are removed. So in this way, we obtain triester of glycerol or triglycerides. Yes, student, question number 8 is, can you describe what happens when milk is converted into curd or yogurt from your understanding of proteins? So you know that proteins, they are macromolecules, and they are formed by the polymerization of the amino acids. And you have also studied about the 4th type of structures of these proteins. This may be primary structure, where the proteins, they exist in the form of linear chains of amino acids. Secondary structure, where some of the linear strands, they folded upon each other, and some folds are present in case of this secondary structure. And the tertiary structure is in the form of a hollow bullion ball, where some protein threads, they are opened, and so many folds are present. And these folds have pocket-like structures. And these pocket-like structures, they are actually the active sites. So they in their tertiary structure, the enzymes, they behave. The proteins, they behave as enzymes. You know very well. Yes, student. And then if we are talking about the quaternary structure, so the quaternary structure of protein shows that here the protein threads, they arrange themselves into various geometrical shapes. It may be cuboids, it may be plates, or some other type of geometrical figures. So the question is, when the we have milk, then this milk have a globular protein type structure. And when this milk is converted into curd or yogurt, then what happens? The complex proteins, after getting some amount of heat, they get denatured. So these are globular proteins, they later convert into the fibrous protein. Therefore, by the process of denaturation here, the secondary and tertiary structure of proteins, they are destroyed. Yes, student, question number 10 is, attempt titrating an amino acid against the weak base and discover the number of dissociating ionizable functional groups in the amino acid. So student, if you use a neutral or a basic type of amino acid and you titrate it against a weak base, in that case, the dissociation takes place. But that dissociation is of only one functional group. Whereas if titration is done between an acidic amino acid and a weak acid, in that case, dissociation of two or more functional groups takes place. So that is the only difference. In case of acidic amino acid, dissociation of more functional groups that takes place. Yes, student, question number 11 is, draw the structure of the amino acid alanine. So you are well familiar with the general formula of the amino acid. So here we have tetravalent carbon and its four valencies are satisfied here by four substituents. At the left hand side, NH2 group is present. At the right hand side, we have carboxylic group. Then at the top, we have hydrogen atom, and at the bottom, we have a variable alkyl group present. If at the place of this variable alkyl group, methyl group is there, then this means that it is the structure of alanine amino acid. Yes, student, what are gums made of? Is Fabicol different? So you must remember, these gums are the heteropolysaccharide. This means they are the carbohydrates having some hetero atoms. And they are made up of two or more different types of monomeric units or monosaccharides. Okay, student? So on the other hand, if we are talking about Fabicol, then this Fabicol is a polyvinyl alcohol and which act as a glue. So it is not a polysaccharide. So that is the difference. Yes, student, question number 13. Give qualitative test for protein, fats, oils, and amino acids. So here you have to write three type of test. First is the biurate test. So this biurate test of proteins, it helps in the identification of the presence of protein. And when you use this biurate reagent, then what happens? The light blue color to purple color, it develops in the solution. So if the solution, it turns into a light blue or purple color, you can easily identify that you are using a stuff which contains a protein. Then second one is the grease test for oil. So here certain oils, it give a translucent stain on brown paper. So these are translucent stains designates that these are the oils or the fats. So this test can be used to show the presence of fat in a vegetable oils. Okay, student, third one is the ninhydrin test. So here you have to use the ninhydrin reagent. And when this ninhydrin reagent is added to the solution, then the colorless solution, it changes to pink, blue, or purple color according to the type of amino acid that you have to test. Yes, student, question number 13 again, question number 14. So here, by mistake, I have written it 13, it is 14. To find out how much cellulose is made by all the plants in the biosphere and compare it with how much of paper is manufactured by man and hence what is the consumption of plant material by man annually and what a loss of vegetation. So here the answer is approximately 100 billion tons of cellulose are made per year by all the plants in the biosphere. And it takes 17 full grown trees to make 1 ton of paper. So trees are also used to fulfill the other requirement of man such as food, timber, medicines, etc. Hence it is very difficult to calculate the annual consumption of plant material by the man. Yes, student, the last question of this chapter is, describe the important properties of enzymes. So students, you must remember, all of these properties that enzymes, they are the complex macromolecules because they are actually the tertiary proteins. And they also have high molecular weight, that is more than 10,000 daltons. Second point is they catalyzed biochemical reactions in the cell. This means they are generally doing their function in living systems and catalyzing biochemical reactions. They are not used for inorganic or organic reactions in laboratories. And third one is enzymes. They do not initiate a reaction. However, they catalyze or accelerate the reaction. No enzyme is initiating a reaction. They are only doing their job of catalysis, or they accelerate the rate of reaction but not initiate the reaction. And fourth point is enzymes, they affect the rate of a biochemical reaction. Okay, students, you know that whenever an enzyme it participates in a chemical reaction, it increases its rate, because you have learned the reaction of this carbon dioxide and water. When they react together, they form carbonic acid. And here one enzyme is involved, that is carbonic anhydrase. So when the reaction takes place in the absence of this enzyme, then in 1 hour, 200 molecules of this carbonic acid is formed. But when a carbonic anhydrase enzyme is used, then in 1 second, 600,000 molecules they are formed. So see the rate by which the enzyme, they increase this reaction. They are not controlling the direction of the reaction, student. And fifth one is most of the enzymes, they have high turnover number. So what is this turnover number? This turnover number of an enzyme is the number of the molecules of a substance that is acted upon by an enzyme per minute. So high turnover number of enzyme, it increases the efficiency of the reaction. This means how many substrate molecules by which these enzymes bind. So point number six is enzymes, they are always specific in their action. They always choose a specific substrate for doing their catalytic activity. So enzyme, their activity decreases with increase in temperature, because you know that enzymes are proteins and their denaturation takes place at high temperature. And they also become inactive at very low temperature, so they always work at optimum temperature. And point number eight is they show maximum activity at an optimum pH, and that is in the range of 6 to 8. Okay, student, the last point is the velocity of the enzyme, and or you can say enzymatic reaction, it increases with increase in the substrate concentration. You know very well, if a particular reaction is catalyzed by an enzyme, then the rate of that reaction or velocity of that reaction, it increases when you increase the concentration of the substrate. But if you keep on increasing the substrate, then you know that there are fewer enzyme molecules, and if all of these enzyme molecules, they are binded with some substrate molecules and no more enzyme is available for further binding, in that case, if you increase the substrate concentration, still there is no change in the rate of the reaction. The rate of reaction will not increase. Okay, student, so that's all regarding the chapter biomolecules. So please, all of you, do these questions in your fair notebooks. So have a nice day. Tomorrow we will start our new chapter, photosynthesis. Thank you, students.